Hi guys, I'd like to introduce parametric design for all learners of multidisciplinary engineering. A nice example to start with is this ball joint assembly, where we can focus on these, the two balls that rotate, and the tightening mechanism, and the threaded ends. So what is a parametric design? Starting from basically mechanical engineering, we have a design that has parameters. And the parameters may vary such that you can produce multiple copies of that design with different characteristics. In this case, we have a small one and a big one of the same joint design. The fascinating thing is this is released by completely different brands for the same function. They both attach with a 1/4-20 screw thread, and they both give you these 6 degrees of freedom to mount your device where you want to mount it in your assembly. Then with these joints, it becomes possible to load many different actuators or lights, cameras, etc., and sensors to your assembly, and it has a very standard interface. Oof. So your camera probably has threads like this on the bottom for webcams and professional photography equipment. So when you make your design and you want to describe all the features, some of these may be variable. In this case, what's interesting is the cast aluminum in black here and the steel of this ball are standard for both brands and many, many more because it's just a good design choice. Stainless steel material and aluminum, those variables don't change across many options. So if your design has variables such as the length, this is an impactful parameter that you may want to vary depending on your application. So will my camera fit? If I mount this bracket to this frame and then I set my camera up on here, can the camera fit? That's going to depend a lot on the distance between these two. So first a design, then a variable, and then we want to take control of that variable. So we make that a parameter. There's a few audiences. One of them is the designers and the manufacturers of the actual part. If we make the parameter this distance between the two centers of the balls, then just changing that variable in your design may cause other features to misalign. And the parametric design means I'm building this model in such a way that I make relationships between the dimensions, or I basically design with intention that you can change this variable and it won't break the model. The model will still serve its function at the design intent, and it will still be able to produce the next step, whichever that is. In the case of 3D printing, the next step is it will still print out successfully. It will still render into an STL that renders into a machine code that will run on your X, Y axis. In the case of the user, it means that I can change this variable, and in this case, for example, they made it longer. That means there will be more torque on the arm given the same camera or device here. So they also increase the size of that ball. So then the designer of these parametric designs needs to make relationships between the parameters, we're getting a little more advanced because this is an assembly now. It's going to take more effort to make a parametric design of an assembly than to make a parametric design of just a part. But these are relationships. So in order to make a parametric part, you can start right away, make a ball, and you're defining the diameter, assign that to a global variable. Now you can pass that model to anyone. They can change this variable and you've retained the design intent. It gets more complicated as you have more features or as you go from a part to an assembly. I like to summarize this whole process in such a way that we say a design goes to from an idea into a design by characterization. Until we describe the material and the dimensions, it's just an idea, not a design. So that's the first thing that that gets us progress. Then, in order to have variables, we need this to essentially be software. So then it needs to be a digital design. When we make some prototype items out of acrylic, for example, we're going to laser cut the acrylic into a nice clear sheet, and it may have holes for features. The holes are described, the dimensions are described, but the material may not be described. Oh my gosh. The material may not be described in the design itself. Most softwares have an option to go ahead and characterize that, but it really doesn't count as a digital part of your design unless you've input that into the model. So everything about this design is characterized, the important things, and then everything that's characterized is digital. The important things that need to be maybe modified or utilized. Then you have a digital design. Finally, if you have a digital design and you add a little more value, you can make it a parametric design. By our definition, the definition I'd like to use is you cannot have a parametric design until you first have a digital design and first have a characterized design. So these are the steps. Now we're in SolidWorks, so let's take a look at this assembly, which has been made parametric. I'll open up the main body, and let's look at how it's made. This is the feature tree. We start with just these axes, and then we start to build features. We add the ribs, and this is all essentially reverse engineering of the part that was off the shelf. All designed from scratch by me. So in this main body, we can edit sketch, and you'll see there's a size of this exterior ball, and there's a distance. 42 millimeters from the center to the center of these axes. So 42 is the large one. And edit sketch. This equals symbol, sigma, means that we're referring to a global variable. This is the first step to make something parametric. So if we close this, then you will see in the configurations, I didn't only make the global variables, but I also made two different configurations of the parts. And you'll see one of them is the 32 millimeters long, and one of them is 42. This one has a large 12 millimeter ball, and this one has a smaller ball at 9 millimeters. Several other components, features are fixed, and a few are variable. So if we go to equations, right click, manage equations, you can find the same type of menu in any professional CAD. Texas A&M University offers the SolidWorks Student Edition for students.
which is very, very elaborate with plugins and so forth. So we created a variable, and this is how you can tell it's software. Ball distance, 32 millimeters. And in this dropdown, we can see that I've applied that value to only this configuration, whereas this dimension is for all configurations. That's the exterior thickness from this flat side to the other flat side. So when we look at another configuration, you'll see that 32 has changed to 42, the ball distance. The ball diameter has changed to 12. Let's come back to the ball diameter. Ball diameter is 9 here. Okay? And you can really help your colleagues if you're working together on a project if you make a couple of parameters that are important for building your assembly, and then they don't need to fully understand your model. You can just communicate to them, all right, these ones you can vary, and it's going to describe another component in our assembly. So then you have a parametric model. One last detail, how to get there, because it's not too easy on the first try to have things all work out. This, your whole feature tree has dependencies. So when I trim the body, that's referring to other features that I've created. And it cannot be broken if it's referring to a feature that changes beyond acceptable parameters. So it will break if you go too far or if you haven't built the model nicely. But I'll show you one big tip. We're going to edit the sketch on the very first feature. This sketch has only 3 dimensions. And actually, this one's driven, so this one doesn't even need to be there. The sketch is fully defined with only these 2 dimensions. And how do we do that? Well, we use constraints. So if you constrain your lines and your geometries to be equal to one another, centered on one another, vertical to set the angle, the less you have described everything with numbers directly, the more your whole model will be ready to cooperate with itself as a two-dimensional area, things become three-dimensional things. So there you have 2 different options for the clamper. Save this, and we're back to the assembly. And then this ball feature also has parameters. This is a neat option. In the assembly, so notice it says solid assembly, we can single click on a part. It's highlighted here, so you know there's 4 parts. You can single click, and you can actually drop down and change the configuration of one of your items. Now you can see if we use the 9mm ball screw, then it's not going to fit inside of this pocket. So I'll undo that, I think. No, I'll select it again. 12 millimeters. Okay, 2 configurations of this, 2 configurations of this, and these 2 components are the same file. All right, and then if we want, we can make a configuration for the whole assembly. Now, the assembly is the 42 millimeter version, and you can right click, show configuration, and you have the 32 millimeter version. This is done cleanly enough that now, if you want to swap between the two in a much bigger assembly, you can start viewing, does my monitor, my camera, my accessories fit in the whole assembly? Or if I move this too far, will it interfere with something? Or is this even the right product to choose? Should I choose the small version or the big version on Amazon? And these are the benefits for someone who's not even the designer and not even the manufacturer. In the 90s and 2000s, the world of software engineering accelerated extremely fast. And it happened because duplicating a design was free and instantaneous, almost. This is the essence of a digital design. So if we start to make our physical hardware digital and we make it parametric, then it becomes just like software, where you write a script, you're performing engineering to make a result, but you leave in that script a variable for an important item that must be modified by another person or modified by AI. You can dream of a million opportunities, but this is the essence of why software is useful. It's because it's very able to be broken down and changed, and the new engineer, new designer, or a business person can capture this value of many hours of engineering done, packaged into a file, and passed to the next person. And this is only useful when, if we share it within a company, that's duplicating value. If we share it in open source, it's a wildly large amount of value that can be captured. But until that software is parametric with variables, it's not very useful to serve any function except for exactly the function of that version at that moment on that operating system. And so when we make our designs parametric in physical, the mechanical world, then your components become valuable to any different group that may need to benefit from it. And you pass this design along, it doesn't need to be re-engineered by someone else. The value that each engineer adds into it can get stacked up and up and up and up. And this is the beauty of open source, and it's a beauty that can only be captured if we make our designs characterized, and then digital, and then parametric. Hope that helps explain some things. Thanks.